GHS 199.
Thank you.
PHS 178. PHS 179.
Jesus' name we pray. Our mighty Father, we thank you, Lord, because of your grace upon us. We thank you, Lord, because out of your mercies you have brought us once again to come and land under your feet. Father, we pray, by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, you are going to speak to every one of us in Jesus' name. By the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, no one among us will go empty-handed. Thank you, O Lord, because you are the Lord that answers prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's open our in book to in 53, in 53.
GHS 53.
I welcome everyone of us to today's service. I pray that the grace of the Lord will continue to be with everyone of us in Jesus' name. By the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, I we will not have a night Fiji, as I said yesterday. I do not know that we have 5 weeks in the month. So it's supposed to be first week and the third week of the month. I'm apologizing for this. I want to remind us of our program, especially for those people who shall be watching us on YouTube or other means. I want to tell us that by the grace of the Lord, we always have our Monday Bible service from 6:50 to 8:30. And then that's where we discuss about the undiluted word of the Lord from our GS, Pastor W.F. Kumoyi. On Thursday, we have our prayer meeting online. And then that number is 712-775-7035. While the access code is 344-823. We can join this one every Thursday from 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock in the evening. Also, our Sunday worship service come up on every Sunday from 8:50 to 11:30. And then we have other meetings, like when we have meeting in GS, which is quarterly. We always want to join them to fellowship with them. As we are doing this, God will continue to bless us in Jesus' name. I pray that the grace of the Lord will continue to be sufficient for us, and the mighty hand of the Lord will be sufficient for everyone of us in Jesus' name. If there's any other means, I will let us know. Let us bring our tithe and offering. As you are bringing our tithe and offering, continue to pray. Call upon the name of the Lord for yourself. That by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, you have come here today. You will not live empty-handed. Call upon the name of the Lord. That God will speak to you. God will speak to me. Call upon the name of the Lord for all the children. That by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, as we are teaching them in the way of the Lord, they will be focused. And the grace of the Lord will take them to destination. Let's pray for each individual, every one of us. That by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, you will not miss me. I will not miss you in the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. Let's pray for each other, one another, that God should energize us to able to invite other people. And those people who are ready for the word of the Lord, God will bring them in Jesus' name. Call upon the name of the Lord, that our efforts will not be in vain. From our fellowship to the Monday Bible study, from Monday Bible study to the prayer meeting, from prayer meeting to the Sunday worship service. That exclude all other meeting we are doing, like workers meeting, like cleaning of the church, like joining them in Washington DC. Let's call upon the name of the Lord, that the grace of the Lord will be sufficient for us to the end, and the glory of the Lord will shine upon our life. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Almighty Father, we glorify your name once again. We thank you, Lord, for what you are doing for us and what you will still continue to do. Father, as we are here, we pray you see to our hearts in Jesus' name, and your name is going to be glorifying our life. Thank you, Lord, because you are the Lord and answer prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. As we are putting our tithe and offering into the bag, continue to pray for those people who does not have, that God will provide for them. Pray for yourself that God should open way. God will surprise you in miraculous way. God will surprise me in miraculous way. All things that look difficult, all things that look insufficient, all things that look like a shortage, all things that look like we are lacking, that by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, God will touch you, God will touch me, God will touch our way. Above our imagination, God will raise our head up in the name of Jesus Christ. that by the power in the blood of Jesus Christ, open doors, God will lead on to them in the name of Jesus Christ. And from henceforth, our way is continuing to be prosperous in spiritually, physically, materially, in the name of Jesus Christ. We shall be the giver and not the receiver only in Jesus' name. We shall be receiver because the blessing of the Lord from the north, from the east, from the west of the world shall come unto us in the name of Jesus Christ. And by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, those people who does not know, they will hear about our name. Those people who have heard about our name, they will know us for the goodness of the Lord. Those people who have known us for the goodness of the Lord, they will know us for eternity. And by the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, on the last day, we will judge with Jesus Christ in Jesus' name. By the power and the blood of Jesus Christ, all things we have been struggling for. And we are pushing ourselves to get there. And it's good for the glory of the Lord. God will make the provision for us. God will make them available for us in Jesus' name. And provision to get to all our destination, to take away sorrow, to wipe away our tears. God will lead us there in the name of Jesus Christ, and the name of the Lord shall be glorified. Thank you, Lord, because you are the Lord that answer prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us be seated. We shall read from our Bible reading, 2 Samuel chapter 18. 2 Samuel chapter 18.
And David numbered the people that were with him, and set captains of thousands and captains of hundreds over them. And David sent forth a third part of the people under the hand of Joab, and a third part under the hand of Abishai the son of Zeruiah, Joab's brother, and a third part under the hand of Ittai the Gittite. And the king said unto the people, I will surely go forth with you myself also. But the people answered, Thou shalt not go forth. For if we flee away, they will not care for us, neither if half of us die will they care for us. But now thou art worth 10,000 of us. Therefore now it is better that thou succor us out of the city. And the king said unto them, What seemeth you best I will do. And the king stood by the gate side, and all the people came out by hundreds and by thousands. And the king commanded Joab and Abishai and Ittai, saying, Deal gently for my sake with the young man, even with Absalom. And all the people heard when the king gave all the captains charge concerning Absalom. So the people went out into the field against Israel, and the battle was in the wood of Ephraim, where the people of Israel were slain before the servants of David, and there was there a great slaughter that day of 20,000 men. For the battle was there scattered over the face of all the country, and the wood devoured more people that day than the sword devoured. And Absalom met the servants of David, and Absalom rode upon a mule, and the mule went under the thick boughs of a great oak, and his head caught hold of the oak, and he was taken up between the heaven and the earth, and the mule that was under him went away. And a certain man saw it, and told Joab, and said, Behold, I saw Absalom hanged in an oak. And Joab said unto the man that told him, And behold, thou sawest him? And why didst thou not smite him there to the ground? And I would have given thee 10 shekels of silver and a girdle. And the man said unto Joab, Though I should receive 1,000 shekels of silver in mine hand, yet would I not put forth mine hand against the king's son. For in our hearing the king charged thee and Abishai and Ittai, saying, Beware that none touch the young man Absalom. Otherwise I should have wrought falsehood against mine own life, for there is no matter hid from the king, and thou thyself wouldest have set thyself against me. Then said Joab, I may not tarry thus with thee. And he took 3 darts in his hand, and thrust them through the heart of Absalom while he was yet alive in the midst of the oak. And 10 young men that bare Joab's armor compassed about and smote Absalom and slew him. And Joab blew the trumpet, and the people returned from pursuing after Israel, for Joab held back the people. And they took Absalom and cast him into a great pit in the wood, and laid a very great heap of stones upon him. And all Israel fled, every one to his tent. Now Absalom, in his lifetime, had taken and reared up for himself a pillar which is in the king's dale. For he said, I have no son to keep my name in remembrance. And he called the pillar after his own name, and it is called unto this day Absalom's place. Then said Ahimaaz the son of Zadok, Let me now run and bear the king tidings, how that the Lord hath avenged him of his enemies. And Joab said unto him, Thou shalt not bear tidings this day, but thou shalt bear tidings another day. But this day thou shalt bear no tidings, because the king's son is dead. Then said Joab to Cushai, Go tell the king what thou hast seen. And Cushai bowed himself unto Joab and ran. Then said Ahimaaz the son of Zadok yet again to Joab, But howsoever, let me, I pray thee, also run after Cushai. And Joab said, Wherefore wilt thou run, my son, seeing that thou hast no tidings ready? But howsoever, said he, let me run. And he said unto him, Run. Then Ahimaaz ran by the way of the plain, and overran Cushai. And David sat between the two gates. And the watchman went up to the roof over the gate unto the wall, and lifted up his eyes, and looked, and behold, a man running along. And the watchman cried, and told the king. And the king said, If he be alone, there is tidings in his mouth. And he came apace, and drew near. And the watchman saw another man running. And the watchman called unto the porter, and said, Behold, another man running alone. And the king said, He also bringeth tidings. And the watchman said, Methinketh the running of the foremost is like the running of Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok. And the king said, He is a good man, and cometh with good tidings. And Ahimaaz called and said unto the king, All is well. And he fell down to the earth upon his face before the king, and said, Blessed be the Lord thy God, which hath delivered up the men that lifted up their hand against my lord the king. And the king said, Is the young man Absalom safe? And Ahimaaz answered, When Joab sent the king's servant, and me thy servant, I saw a great tumult, but I knew not what it was. And the king said unto him, Turn aside and stand here. And he turned aside and stood still. And behold, Cushai came. And Cushai said, Tidings, my lord the king, for the Lord hath avenged thee this day of all them that rose up against thee. And the king said unto Cushai, Is the young man Absalom safe? And Cushai answered, The enemies of my lord the king and all that rise against thee to do thee hurt be as that young man is. And the king was much moved, and went up to the chamber over the gate, and wept. And as he went, thus he said, O my son Absalom, my son Absalom, would God I had died for thee. O Absalom, my son, my son.
God bless his word in our heart in Jesus' name. We shall listen to him. Choir song.
Tonight. We thank you for the series you are starting with us today. Strength is perfect. Let us pray. Our God and our Father, we thank you for the Bible study tonight. We thank you for the series you are starting with us today on the book of the Psalms. We're praying that along with the choir members singing, you will open our eyes that we may see the things you have preserved for us in your word tonight in Jesus' name. And we pray that as we go through this series of the studies on the Psalms, that the devotion, the a faith that trusts in God, and the benefits we ought to receive from these devotional studies, you will grant unto every one of us in Jesus' name, as you have promised us the Holy Spirit, that he will teach us all things. He will guide us into all truth. He will bring into our remembrance the things that you have preserved for us in your word. We are praying and claiming in faith the assistance and the help of the Holy Ghost, so that your truth will be revealed to everyone coming to these studies in Jesus' name. And Father, we pray that every week as we come, you will enrich our lives. You will make us strong in the inner man, so that we will be able to walk the way of faith. Like you have taught the Bible characters, we too will be able to do the same. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name, we pray. Today, as you learned last week, we're starting a new series. And the series is on the Psalms of David and the other writers that God used to pen or to write the Psalms. Obviously, as you will expect, we will not be able to study all the Psalms. That will take us 3 years, week by week. We may be able to group some of the Psalms together, but we'll do enough of the Psalms to be able to get all that the Lord has preserved for us in the book of the Psalms. Today being the introductory lesson, or the introductory study to the book of the Psalms, I'll say some general things concerning the book of the Psalms itself, so you will be able to launch into the deep and get a feel of what the Lord has preserved for us in this part of the world. The major part of the Psalms has for their subject the praises of the Lord. That means in many parts of the Psalms, you will see that the psalmist instructs and leads the readers to praising the Lord. And therefore it was called by the Jews the Book of Praises. And actually, originally, the Psalms were intended to be sung in the Jewish service. But it is not only limited to singing. We are to admonish one another. We are to teach one another in the Psalms, which is the reason for our coming together to study the Psalms. If you look at Colossians chapter 3, verse 16, it says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord." In that verse of scripture, you will see very clearly, it says that an area where we can admonish ourselves, encourage ourselves, lift up ourselves, and teach one another is the area of the Psalms. This is the reason why we're studying the Psalms at this time, because there is a lot of teaching, a lot of admonition, a lot of instruction, exhortation, and encouragement in the book of the Psalms. In Luke chapter 24, Jesus Christ taught his own disciples. Not only that he taught his disciples out of the Psalms, he regarded the Psalms as part of Scripture from which we can get doctrine, from which we can get instruction and correction and rebuke. In Luke chapter 24, from verse 44, "And he said unto them, These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures." Here Jesus Christ explained to his own disciples things that were written concerning him. And he picked those things out of the law of Moses, out of the writing of the prophets, and out of the Psalms. That tells you something. That as the Pentateuch, that means Genesis to Deuteronomy, were inspired of the Lord. And as the writings of the prophets were inspired of the Lord, in the same way, to the same level, for the same purpose, the Psalms were inspired of the Lord. Not only that, if you look at verse 45, it says, he opened their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures. Two things stand out very clearly there. One, the law of Moses was regarded by Jesus as scripture. Two, the prophets were regarded by Jesus as the scriptures. And three, the Psalms were regarded by the Lord Jesus Christ as scripture. Not only that, he opened their understanding. You have seen, as we have studied parts of Exodus and parts of Leviticus in our Sunday scriptures on Sunday, that we need our eyes to be opened. We need instruction and teaching. We need a lot of application or explanation before we can understand the law of Moses. Not only that, as we have read together, we have studied Daniel sometimes, you will see that it takes a lot of teaching, a lot of instruction, exposition, before we can understand the writings of the prophets. But understand that it takes the same teaching, instruction, and exposition before we can understand the book of the Psalms. That's the reason at this time we're studying the Psalms. Because we need our eyes to be opened so that we can understand the things that are written in the Psalms. Not only that, you will see, in fact, as we study Psalm 2 next week, you will see that many of the Psalms are written concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. You cannot fully know Christ except you study the Psalms and you see the things that were written concerning him. When you think about it, that the disciples had doubt concerning the resurrection of Jesus Christ and concerning the ministry of Jesus Christ, concerning the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus, in order to convince them about his ministry and about what the Lord had given him to do and about his resurrection, he had to go into the Psalms, telling and teaching of the things that were written aforetime concerning him. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. From verse 20. For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and his bishopric let another take. The early church, very few people, 120 believers, disciples, they needed a major decision in the church, and it was the decision to replace the ministry of Judas Iscariot. Judas Iscariot had fallen away. He had betrayed the Lord Jesus Christ and eventually had committed suicide. And they wanted to make up the number of the apostles so that from 11, they will become 12. And there was a place in the Psalms that they needed to refer to settle all disputation, to settle the minds of the early church, that it had been written and prophesied in the Psalms that there would be a person like Judas Iscariot. And that after he had left the bishopric or the ministry, that let another person take that office. If the believers of that time could refer back to the Psalms, it's settling one of their greatest problems at that time. How much more today, that the believers and the church as a whole should have a better understanding of the Psalms, so that when confusion or controversy, when difficulties arise in your personal life or in your family life or in the church, we'll be able to refer to the Psalms concerning the things that are written aforetime to settle all those things. That's the reason at this time that we're getting into the study of the Psalms. There are a lot of questions in your mind that the Psalms will answer. Acts chapter 13, from verse 32. Acts 13, verse 32. And we declare unto you glad tidings, how that the promise which was made unto the fathers, God has fulfilled the same unto us their children, in that he hath raised up Jesus again, as it is also written in the second Psalm, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. You can see from the verses I've read that the apostles there were preaching an evangelistic message. I've shown you the importance of the Psalms to the believers. Jesus Christ, in order to settle his own disciples, he referred to the Psalms so that they will see all the things that had been done to him: his betrayal, his crucifixion, his death, and his resurrection. They are according to what had been written in the law of Moses, in the prophets, and in the Psalms. And he settled and established the church, the believers, in referring to the Psalms. Not only that, as they needed to replace Judas Iscariot, a matter they needed to settle within the church, they had to refer to the book of the Psalms. Now we come to the people of the world. There are people that have not been born again, and they need the evangelistic message. And there is a lot for the unbeliever, a lot for the sinner. As we will see in our study of the Psalms, here we are told that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. And now we refer to the book of the Psalms. It says, as also it is written in the second Psalm, Thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. And as concerning that he raised him up from the dead, now no more to return to corruption, he said, on this wise I will give you the sure mercies of David. Wherefore, he says also in another psalm, Thou shalt not suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. If you have read the New Testament very well, you will see that the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is an important part of the gospel message. Because no one can be saved, no one can be born again, except he believes in his heart and he confesses with his mouth that God raised him from the dead. And here again, the psalm is referred to, verse 35, wherefore he saith also in another psalm, Thou shalt not suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. For David, after he had served his own generation, by the will of God, fell on sleep, and was laid unto his fathers, and saw corruption. But he, whom God raised again, saw no corruption. I believe you see the importance of the Psalms. And this is the reason why we're studying the Psalms. We, as a church, we need the writings of the Psalms. And the unbelievers too, they need the Psalms. And so, whether you are a saint or a sinner, as we come all through these Mondays in our new series on the Psalms, you will find a lot that is meant for your comfort, for your encouragement, a lot that is meant to uplift you in your Christian life. The Psalms, inspired by God, as all scriptures are, were penned by various authors. The penman, that is the writer, the author of most of them, was David, the son of Jesse. These Psalms instruct and lead us to trust in God, to praise the Lord, and to pray unto him. They show us ways in which we keep communion with him in all the various conditions and circumstances of the human life. Today we're starting with Psalm 1, an appropriate introduction to the book of the Psalms. Psalm 1, let's look at it. I read to you from verse 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. The Psalms open with this first psalm, and it talks of blessedness. Now, the key to the Psalms is hung at the door. At the very threshold of the book of the Psalms, we have the way to blessedness, which means then, if you will study aright, the Psalms will show you the way of happiness, the way for solid spiritual pleasure, the way of having joy unspeakable, or the fullness of joy. Because at the very beginning, we are told how we can be blessed by the Lord. Just like Jesus opened up his ministry in the Beatitudes, and he tells us the way of the blessed, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit. In the same way, David, the psalmist, opens up in the Psalms, and he says, this is the way of blessedness. He says, blessed is the man. Which man? An Israelite? Not necessarily. Which man? A Gentile? Not necessarily. Which man? Whosoever. Because you see, it tells us, it doesn't tell us the way of blessedness or the man that is blessed by name. It tells us the man that is blessed by description. And it says, it is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. It is the man that standeth not in the way of sinners. It is the man that sitteth not in the seat of discomfort. That's the difficulty here. The difficulty is this. The psalmist recognizes the fact that we are born in sin. We are conceived in sin. The psalmist recognizes the fact that it's not righteous. No, not one. The psalmist recognizes the fact that everyone walks in the wicked way. How then can we come into the way of blessedness? How then we will not walk in the way of discomfort? How shall we not stand in the way of sinners? How shall we not sit in the seat of discomfort? Look at Psalm 58, verse 3. The wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they be born, speaking lies. Psalm 51, verse 5. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Here we learn from the psalmist that there is none righteous, no, not one, that we were conceived in sin. We were born in sin. And therefore, the natural thing for everyone to do is to walk the way of sin, is to go with sinners and to sit in the seat of discomfort. How then will a man born in sin, conceived in sin, raised up in sin, how then will a man that has gone astray from the point that he was even born into this world, how then will that man come into the blessedness of the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, that standeth not in the seat, in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of discomfort? There's only one way: by repentance, praying to the Lord, and asking forgiveness from the Lord. That's what we call being born again. In Psalm 32, verse 1, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. Now you can understand this psalm. It's not telling us that man can live a righteous life on his own. Psalm 1 is not telling us that in your own strength, in your own power, you can refuse to stand in the way of sinners, or you can refuse to walk in the way of the ungodly, or you can refuse to sit in the seat of discomfort. In your own strength, you are a sinner. In your own power, you remain a sinner, because you are born in sin. In sin did your mother conceive you. But then it says, when your sins are forgiven, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. When you come to the Lord in repentance, and you say, I know that I am a sinner. I know that I have missed my way. I know that I was conceived in sin. I know that I was born in sin. I know that even as soon as I was born, I went astray. But I want the blessedness of the righteous. It is only then that you will be forgiven. And then all your iniquity will not be imputed unto you anymore. He will cleanse you. He will take away all your sins. Then you become redeemed. And as the redeemed of the Lord, you get into the blessedness of the Lord. In Psalm 40, verse 4. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust, and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. How do we become believers in the Lord? One, we repent of our sins. That's what we read about in Psalm 32. Two, we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's by the way of faith. Now, you may think that the Old Testament people only depended upon the blood of the animal. Without trusting in the Lord, without believing in the Lord. Of course, they believed in the Lord. Look at Psalm 40 verse 6. Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears hast thou opened. Burnt offering and sin offering hast thou not required. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. This is looking forward to the time when the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, will come. The Old Testament people knew that ultimately it is not just the blood of bulls and goats. It is not just the old sacrifices or Old Testament sacrifices. It is in the trust, in the faith that they had in God, the God that ordained those things. What the psalmist was saying here is that the sacrifices themselves, without believing in the Lord that ordained it, will not give them forgiveness. They were trusting in the Lord. That's why you have read in verse 4, blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust. This is how they came into the blessedness of Psalm 1 and of the Psalms that we'll be studying in Psalm 65, verse 4. Blessed is the man whom thou choosest and causest to approach unto thee, that he may dwell in thy courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of thy house, even of thy holy temple. The psalmist recognizes that the sinner is separated from the Lord. The sinner is rejected by the Lord. But when you confess your sins, asking for forgiveness, according to Psalm 32, you are forgiven. All your iniquities are taken away from you. Your iniquities are not imputed unto you anymore. And according to Psalm 40, where we have read, you trust in the Lord. And as you trust in the Lord, then he chooses you. He chooses you for his own. He redeems you. And that's why it says, you are a chosen generation. Ye have not chosen him, but I have chosen you. And then he causes you to approach unto him. The middle wall of partition is broken down. All the things that separated you from the Lord, they are totally taken away, that he may dwell in thy courts. You become a member of the family of God. And thereafter, you will be satisfied with the goodness of his house. Let's go back to Psalm 1. Verse 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. This man we're talking about, this is the man that had been redeemed of the Lord. But there is one thing that characterizes the life of the redeemed. It is purity. That's why we have titled the first part of the study, The Purity of the Redeemed. And if you are a child of God, this is what will characterize your life. One, you do not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Two, you do not stand in the way of sinners. Three, you do not sit in the seat of the scornful. There's a lot to say about that verse, but look at this. That if you are a child of God, your life is characterized by purity. What is purity? Purity is that thing that makes you totally different from the sinner, from the ungodly, from the scornful. When a man is totally different from the sinner, that man is pure. Different in the heart, different in his motives, different in his lifestyle. When a person will not walk, will not stand, will not sit with the sinners, the ungodly, and the scornful. When a person will not go the way of the unbeliever, that's the redeemed of the Lord. That man is pure before the Lord. Look at Proverbs chapter 1. From verse 10. My son, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. You can see the difference here between the son and the sinner. The sinners are not children of God. But my son, if you become a child of God, if you have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, if sinners entice thee, consent thou not. Which means, if you are a real child of God, you will be pure. You will be different from the sinner. Look at verse 15. My son, walk not thou in the way with them. Refrain thy foot from their path. You will be different. Like we learned yesterday at the Sunday worship. You will not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. In Ephesians chapter 4. From verse 17. Ephesians chapter 4. From verse 17. This I say therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind. If you have been redeemed, if you have become a child of God, your life will be totally different from the people of the world. You will not walk as other Gentiles walk. You will not go the way of the unbeliever. Verse 22. That she put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. And in verse 28, let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor working with his hands the things which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And so, if we are children of God, then that means we have had assurance that our sins have been forgiven. We have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Now our lives are totally different from the lives of the people of the world. The redeemed of the Lord will be pure and holy. Come back to Psalm 1, verse 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sitteth in the seat of the sinners, nor standeth in the way of the sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. I want to show you here that the Lord has placed before us two ways. He says, I place before you the way of life and the way of death. I place before you blessing or cursing, or curse. Choose life that you may live. If you choose the way of the Lord, if you walk in the path of righteousness, the blessing of the Lord will be upon you. What will characterize your life? One, you will live a pure life. Two, you will delight in the law of the Lord. Verse 2, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. The righteous is characterized by meditation in the word of the Lord. The temptation is to meditate on your circumstances, to meditate on the injury that people have caused you, to meditate on the poverty that you may be going through, to meditate on your circumstances, or to meditate on misunderstandings and misrepresentations on the problems of life. Do you know when you meditate on those things, your mind, your heart will shift away from the platform or from the place of righteousness where you are. If you meditate on your persecution, on your problems, on the things you are going through, you'll become despondent. You'll get into despair. But the righteous will not meditate on the circumstances of life. He will meditate on the word of God in the day and in the night. In the day when the sun is shining, In the day when there is a bright light, in the day when all things appear to be prosperous, he meditates upon the word of God. In prosperity, he meditates upon the commandments of the Lord. The commandments of the Lord that will shield him from pride, from temptation, from the ways of the world. But in the night when there is no light, in the night of sorrow, in the night of affliction, he will not meditate on what the world is doing against him. He will not meditate upon his circumstance. He meditates upon the promises of God. In the day, meditate upon the commandments, so that your joy, your happiness will not make you to forget yourself and go astray. In the night when things are hard, when the sun is not shining, when it is dark and cloudy and gloomy, meditate upon the promises of the Lord. Delight all the time in the word of the Lord. This is how you can remain in the blessing of the Lord. But you see, many times, some people in their problem, even though they have been born again before, they have been children of God, they begin to get near the unbelievers. And you know how they start? They start walking in the way, in the counsel of the ungodly. You see a man who has been fervent before, a man who has been blessed of the Lord before, a man who has been redeemed before, but you see him now, he's backsliding. Little by little, he is walking in the counsel of the ungodly. Instead of seeking counsel from the word of God, instead of seeking counsel from children of God, instead of seeking counsel from leaders that God has appointed in the church, he'll be seeking counsel from the ungodly. And the ungodly will begin to sympathize with him. The ungodly will begin to tell him, look at your condition. Why are you still a Christian? Why are you still going to that church? And in walking in the counsel of the ungodly, he begins to practice what they are telling him. Before long, he will be standing in the way of sinners. You see, when a person is backsliding, you progress in backsliding. You start by just asking for advice from sinners. You start by just getting near and saying to sinners, what do you think about this? You start by telling your boss, who is an unbeliever, well, my boss, I know that this is not an area of our work together, but I'm thinking about marriage. I'm thinking about a new job. I'm thinking about my life. I'm thinking about this. Well, I know that you are older than I am. You are my boss, even though I'm a church man, even though I'm a church lady, and maybe you don't go to church, but from your own experience and wisdom in life, my boss, I depend on you. What do you think about this? That's the beginning of backsliding. Or maybe you go to your mother, you go to your father, and your mother or your father may not be a Christian, not born again yet. You have the word of God. David is old enough to be your father. Moses is old enough to be your father. Abraham is old enough to be your father. All these people, patriarchs and prophets and people in the Bible, they're old enough to be your daddy and your mommy. Why not go to them? Why not go to the scriptures and say, well, I will ask. When David was in trouble, how did he manage in that trouble? When Moses was in controversy and confusion, how did he manage himself through? Those people are old enough to counsel us, and the word of God is enough. How about Jesus Christ, the Ancient of Days? We have just studied all of those parables and all the statements. How about Paul the Apostle, Paul the Aged? Is he not old enough to counsel you? But you see, many times we leave all these Bible books and characters, and we go to the unbelievers, we say, what do you think I should do? It is the beginning of backsliding. And then you begin to walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Then you make progress in your backsliding. You stand in the way of sinners. You are walking along with them before. You stand in the way with them. You spend more time. You stand with them. You are now becoming even rigid in your opinion with these people. You are now making real solid friendship with them, that you are standing in the way of sinners. Before long, you will progress from just walking and standing. You will be sitting in their seat. You will know their jokes. You will know all the pranks they play, all the things they say to tease and to tempt and to torture the believers. You will know all about them. Before long, you will be casting the same joke. Before long, you will be sitting in the seat of discomfort. Before long, you will be saying, that's how they have been saying, Jesus will come, Jesus will come. You will be sitting in the seat of discomfort. Before long, you'll be saying, that's how they were saying, don't marry an unbeliever, don't marry an unbeliever. You will be sitting in the seat of the scornful. And you know the way of the backslider is very, very slippery. The moment you begin to walk in the way, in the counsel of the ungodly, if you are not careful, before long, you'll be standing in the way of sinners. If you are not careful, before long, you will be sitting in the seat of the scornful. But let's remain the redeemed of the Lord. Because if we remain the redeemed of the Lord, blessings will come upon our lives. And as we read in the book of the Psalms, you will see the blessedness that the Lord has preserved for the people of God. Let's look now at the provision for the righteous. From verse 1 again, blessed is the man. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. It shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Here we have the provision of the Lord. You see, when you plant a garden, when you plant a seed, you water it, you take care of it, you protect it until it will bring forth fruit. The righteous is planted by the Lord, by the rivers of many waters. And the Bible says it will be fruitful and it will flourish like a tree. Psalm 92 from verse 12. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. It shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. You know, sometimes it's unfortunate that many people who do not understand the way of the Lord, they counsel young people, they advise young people. Sometimes an unbeliever will call a young lady or a young man, or maybe a teenager, and he will say, well, you're too young to be going to church every time. You are too young to concentrate on religion now. You see, all those people that are preaching to you, or don't you know about that your pastor? Or he finished his education, he was even lecturing at the university, and then now he has time for religion. You finish your education and then you will have time for religion. Don't you see all those people that are now carrying Bible and they are preaching? So look at so and so, look at so and so. They became old before they started all this religion. You are too young. As a teenager, concentrate on your studies. Concentrate on this or concentrate on that. When you have finished all that, then in life, you will, if you want to go to church, that will be all right. Or before you get married, people might call you, your mother might call you and say, this religion is too much. But I'm not saying you should not be religious, but at least get married first and have children and build a house. And when you have settled, then you can face religion. And it is also unfortunate for fathers and mothers who come to church, and a church like this, if they see their teenage boy or teenage girl, the teenage boy wants to be in the choir, the teenage girl wants to be in the choir, and all these young people, they want to read Bible, they want to evangelize, they want to take part in house fellowship, they want to take part in all these programs in the church, even though these parents themselves, they are members of the church, even though these parents themselves, they say they are born again, they will call their children, they will say, come. You see, I'm a Christian. And you know I'm even a worker in our Deeper Life Church. But you are too young. Now that I'm a Christian, look at the house I've built for you to live in. Look at the car I'm using. Look at the place I'm working. As my child, let me advise you. Go to church on Sunday. And then anytime you have bad dream and anytime you have any sickness, you can go on Thursday. Monday, I will bring outline for you. You can read that on Sunday at your spare time. But you are too young to be too religious and righteous now. I'm your father. I'm a Christian. I'm not telling you to backslide. Remain a Christian, but don't do too much of it. When you're as old as I am, then you can work for God. Those people do not realize that when we delight in the law of God, that we'll be blessed by the Lord. They are teaching their children that if you follow the Lord will not bless you. They are teaching their children that if they follow the Lord, they will not prosper in life. But it says, if we follow the Lord, you will be like a tree planted. It says, the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. It shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the court of our God. Which means that if from your own young age, you give yourself to the Lord, of course you will be fruitful. Of course the Lord will bless you. He will bless you with all spiritual and material and physical blessings. On the other hand, we have some other people who, when they were younger in the Lord and younger in age, they gave a lot of their time to the Lord serving the Lord. But now they say, well, I've given that work of the Lord for the rest of the people. I am getting old now. They say they are now above 50 or maybe above 60 or maybe they are now above 70. And they say now they cannot work for God anymore. That's why we do not have many old people in our choir. We have a few old people there. But we do not have many old people there. Because many of the old people, they say, they think that the choir is meant for young people. As I travel about, I come across, some situations like that. In one deeper life church in one of the states where I traveled, all those I saw in their choir, they must be from primary school to secondary school, secondary two level. I think all of them must have been about the age of 14 and 13 or 12. All the other people above 20, above 30, I didn't find any of them in the choir. And I spoke to some of the leaders there. I said, what's the matter with you? Old people here, you don't sing for the Lord. Jesus sang. The apostles sang. And the disciples and believers in the New Testament, they sang. How about you people? They make the church like all these, ancient Orthodox churches where only primary school children are in the choir. It is because they have a wrong impression that old people do not serve the Lord. But look at verse 14. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. If you are getting old, where is your fruit? If you are getting old, where is your service for the Lord? If you are getting old, where is your ministry for the Lord? And young people, you are planted already in the court of the Lord. Keep on bearing fruit. And as we grow old, let us keep on bearing fruit. Let's see the blessedness of the believer now in the New Testament. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 from verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Whatever spiritual blessings you have seen in the New Testament that other people received, you can receive. Did people in the Bible days get saved? You too can get saved. Were people in Bible days sanctified and made holy? You too can be sanctified and made holy. Have you seen the blessing of the Lord, spiritual blessing upon Enoch, that he walked with God 300 years without going astray, without backsliding? You too can have such a blessing. Have you seen Daniel, that he had a spiritual blessing, that even in Babylon, he will not deny the Lord? You too can have such a spiritual blessing. Have you seen Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that they took their stand, and they had such a steadfast faith in the Almighty God? You too can have such a blessing. Have you seen the New Testament believers being baptized in the Holy Ghost? You too can have a blessing. Have you seen them having the blessing of answered prayer? You too can have all the spiritual blessings in Christ. In 2 Peter chapter 2, chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life. Think about that. He has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. Well, salvation, sanctification, Holy Ghost baptism, steadfastness and faith to resist temptation and the devil, all that pertains to godliness. But he has also given us all things pertaining unto life. Pertaining unto life. You need healing? That's part of the all things pertaining to life. You need deliverance? That's part of all things pertaining to life. You need provision? That's part of all things pertaining to life. And he has provided for us all those blessings. Who are the heirs of those blessings? According to Psalm 1, verses 2 and 3, these blessings we have read about, whether they're spiritual or they're physical or material, they are for the people that delight in the law of the Lord, who meditate in the word of God day and night. These are the people that will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bring forth fruit in the season, and the leaf shall not wither. And it says, whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. When you look at a child of God, it doesn't matter where you put him. Doesn't matter where you put him. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Have you thought about the life of Joseph? It doesn't matter where you put that man. Put him in Potiphar's house, he prospers. Put him in the prison, he prospers. Bring him back out of the prison and get him to Pharaoh's presence, he prospers. Get him in the time of prosperity, 7 years prosperity, he prospers. And put him in the midst of a famine, 7 years of scarcity, he prospers. Put him in the midst of friends or foes, he prospers. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Have you thought about Daniel? In the matters concerning the kingdom, at the time of Nebuchadnezzar, he prospered. When he ruled at the time of Belshazzar, he prospered. In the time of Darius, he prospered as well. And it doesn't matter where you place a righteous man, the righteous man will prosper in whatsoever he does. You see, sometimes you have believers and they say, well, I don't know why I'm not prospering in this area, and they change the job, they go to another thing. After 6 months again, well, maybe this is not my way, they change job, they go to another thing. After 1 year, I don't know why I'm not prospering, they change jobs again. Whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Look at the church work. If a man is actually a rich child of God, and is meditating day and night in the word of the Lord, put him among the ushers, he will do it excellently well. And remove him there and put him in the choir, he will do excellently well. And remove him from there and make him to officiate in the house fellowship, he will do excellently well. Remove him from the house fellowship and bring him to the central church and let him do something, he will do excellently well. And call him out of that and tell him that, want you to supervise the building or, you know, the physical area of the work. Put him there, he will do excellently well. You know why? Because the Holy Ghost in him will do well anywhere. You know, if you really have the Holy Ghost within you, if they place you there as an usher, you will do well. If the Holy Ghost is there within you, if they place you as a member of the choir, you will do well. Because it is not you, it is the Holy Ghost within you. You know, sometimes you give assignment to some people and you tell them, brother or sister, go and do this. Well, they said, I cannot do that. But Paul the Apostle said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. If you are a child of God and you are part of the redeemed, part of the blessedness of the redeemed is that whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Let's look now at the rebels or the rebellious. From verse 4, the ungodly are not so. What does that mean? It says the believers will bear fruit. The ungodly are not so. It says the believers will do well anywhere you place them. The ungodly are not so. It says whatever the season, whatever the time, the godly people, the blessed people, the righteous redeemed, they'll be bearing fruit in every season. the ungodly are not so. Think about every good thing in the life of the believer. Put a minus, a negative, in front of it. That is what the unbeliever will have. If the believer is happy, put a minus before that. That's sadness. The unbeliever will have it. If the believer is prospered, put a minus, a negative sign before that. There is poverty. The unbeliever will have that. If the believer has joy, put a negative sign before that. Then you have sorrow. The unbeliever will have that. If the believer is expecting having a hope of eternal life, living with God in heaven, put a negative thing before that. The unbeliever must be expecting to live in the fire of hell forever. Any good thing that happens to the believer, put a negative thing on that. That's for the unbeliever. The ungodly are not so, but are like chaff which the wind driveth away. Which the wind driveth away. The wind of judgment, the wind of adversity, the wind of the wrath of God will drive the ungodly away, as the wind drives the chaff away. And you see, when the wind drives chaff away, it drives it to only one place. That's the place of burning. And if you are the ungodly, the wind is blowing you already. The wind is driving you already. And if you do not stop and repent, there is nothing that will stop the force of that wind. You might go on until it blows you into the fire of hell. It says, therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. What it means is that on the day of judgment, there will be no excuse at all. You will not be able to defend yourself. All the books of the Bible will be against you. All the angels of God will be against you. All the redeemed of the Lord will be against you. All the examples and illustrations and the mercies of God from the eternal past to the eternal future will be against you. All the force and all the authority of the Almighty God will be against you. Think about yourself, a human being. You stand in the presence of God, and all the angels of God witness against you. Gabriel, Michael, all the other angels, they witness against you. They say you must be condemned. How can you stand in judgment? And the Almighty Father, God Almighty, the Ancient of Days, he witnesses against you with all the knowledge he has against you. That's why the ungodly will not stand in the day of judgment. Not only that, your neighbors who believed in the Lord, those of us who have seen your life, those of us, don't you know, we shall judge angels and we shall judge the unbelievers, even the company of the redeemed of the Lord in their millions and billions. They will stand against you in the court of law here in the nation. When five people are standing against you, can you stand? When 10 people are witnessing against you that they saw you, they caught you with cocaine, they caught you with that crime, they caught you with that thing that is evil, can you stand? Think about when you come in the presence of God and God is against you, and Jesus is witnessing against you, and the Holy Ghost that had been drawing you and pulling you and pleading with you, and you rejected, and he witnesses against you, and then they bring all the angels of God to come and witness, and they witness against you, and then they bring all the redeemed of the Lord, your believing husband, your believing wife, your believing children, your believing neighbors, they all witness against you, and above all, the devil that you served, and the fallen angels that you served, they all came also and they said, he is our member, he is part of us, they should go to hell with us, and they all witness against you. The ungodly shall not stand in judgment. Like Belshazzar, your knees will knock together. The sin will cover your mouth. Shame will cover you like a blanket. And then it says, sinners shall not stand in the congregation of the righteous, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. But the Lord is calling you today. If you will call upon the Lord today, today is still the day of mercy. And you can say, I do not want to face that. When God will be against me, Christ will be against me, Holy Ghost will be against me, angels will be against me, the congregation of the righteous will be against me. I want to make my way right with the Lord today. If you will call upon the Lord today, he will save you. He will take away all your sins. If you are a backslider, if you are a backslider, that day is coming when all of heaven and hell will witness against you. When all the angels of God will witness against you, and they will tell you, you belong to a church like this, where the word of God is preached, without fear, without favor. You belong to a church like this, where the way of redemption, the way of salvation has been made plain, and you tasted the word of salvation, the blessing of salvation before, but you went back to serve the devil. All heaven and hell and earth will witness against you. How will you be able to stand on that day? But the Lord is calling you, and he's saying, today you can repent. Now, believers, you are a child of God. Keep on standing. Keep on believing the Lord, because the day is coming when eternal blessedness will be upon you. In Revelation chapter 21 and verse 3, and I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is thirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Believers, keep on looking up to the Lord. There may be a little temptation now, a little trial now. There may be a little difficulty now. There may be a little problem now. Don't look at that, because blessedness is coming eventually. The Lord will bless you on earth. He will bless you in heaven. He will bless you in time. He will bless you in eternity. And all the people of the ages that will be in heaven, they will know that you are among the blessed people of the Lord. Backsliders, what are you waiting for? Call upon the Lord. Do not wait for the time when heaven, hell, and earth will be against you. Sinners, what are you waiting for? Do not wait for the time when all hell and heaven and earth will be against you. Let's rise up. Talk to the Lord in prayer. Come into the blessedness of the Lord. The Lord is calling you. The Lord is expecting you. Are you the man that is not walking in the way of sinners? Are you the man that is not standing in the way of sinners? Are you the man that is not sitting in the seat of discomfort? Are you delighting yourself in the word of the Lord? Are you meditating on the word of God day and night? Are you being fruitful? Are you being blessed by the Lord? Are you known by the Lord as a righteous, redeemed individual? Or are you a rebel? Are you a sinner? Are you a backslider? Are you waiting for the time when you will not be able to stand in judgment? The Lord is calling you. The Lord is calling you. Come to the Lord.
At the pastor, surrender your will, surrender your way, so that you can be blessed. We have had the way of blessedness since yesterday. God has been talking to us about serving him. Call upon the name of the Lord. That the way of blessedness is to serve God when we have the ability. When we have not by the word, goodbye. Call upon the name of the Lord, that we will serve him. In your young age, when you are in middle age, when you are old, talk less among us than no one that is old. Call upon the name of the Lord. You surrender your work. You surrender yourself. You surrender your time. You surrender your property. You surrender it for the glory of the work of the Lord. Call upon him. Accept him. If you are still doubting your salvation, do not forget, the only thing you need is to confess by your tongue, confess by your mouth, that you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you walk in that way of the Lord. This night is another night of opportunity. Confess your sin. Thank you. tell God, this way you have been coming. This way you are. And this is what is causing confusion. This is the hard thing that you are thinking is not solvable. You cannot solve it. Call upon the name of the Lord. Present your case before him. He loves you. He doesn't want your condemnation. He has not condemned you. He doesn't want you to perish. All what he wants is, here I am, my Father. I am back. Call upon him. Father, I renew my confidence within you. Amen. And surrender all afresh. When I'm talking about surrender all afresh, not only your house, not only your money, not only your talent, but you surrender your whole body. You said, Father, I surrender all. I surrender all. I surrender all without looking back. I surrender all without looking forward. I surrender all without managing what you are giving to me. And those things, instead of leading me to kingdom of God, they want to lead me to the other side of the kingdom. Call upon the name of the Lord. Father, in all gentleness, in all humility, in all spirit of lowliness, I come unto you, Lord. I come unto you, Lord. I come without any murmuring. I come without any complaint. I come without any excuse. I come without any buts. But Lord, here I am. Accept me, Lord. Accept me, Lord. Let your grace be sufficient for me. As it was sufficient for Joseph, that anywhere, any place, any area, any situation, any condition, any environment, he find himself, he is prosperous. You want to tell me, Joseph has the grace? Yes, it is grace. But you have the grace, you still have Jesus Christ. That make you multiple billion better than Joseph. Call upon the name of the Lord. God, see me through. See me through. See me through. In this line of suffering, in this land of compromising, in this land of those people who are serving God, they are nothing before the people of the world. In this land, there's no praises, there's no appraiser for belonging unto the world. I mean, belonging unto the Lord. But when you belong to the world, people knows you. But I want you to know, there's a reward for you in the kingdom of God. Which one do you want to choose? Eternity, or something worldly? Call upon the name of the Lord. I know there's a better place for me, and I'm looking at that day. I will see those people who have gone in my family, in my Christian family, in my family, my friend that they have left me behind, the family that have left me behind, this Christian brother that have left me behind, the Christian sister that have left me behind, and they wave goodbye to this world. God, I'm looking at that day. I will meet them again on your foot. My pleading is this: Almighty God, count me worthy. Count me worthy. Count me worthy. Where the roll is being called. When they are searching for the names of those who are going to make it to the kingdom of God. On those who are going to dwell with the Jesus Christ. Father, I know this particular person is there. I know this particular person is there. I know he's enjoying with you, oh Lord. Why will I be found missing? Is this particular thing, oh Lord? Father, I resubmit my life. Take me there, oh Lord. Take me there, oh Lord. Everyone is sweet.